Simpler then, and it may be than it was, but it sure seemed powerful, complicated at the time. It was almost always warm and dry, like the streets of St. Petersburg, Missouri, running right on down to the river. Oh, and life was, oh, full of beauty, too. Kind of awful beauty that can set a boy to thinking that, why, there are some things in this old world so great that he, by comparison, is of mighty little significance. Tom himself has sat on those rocks right on down by the river there many a time, watching the summer sunrise while the hidden birds piping develop into a joyous riot of music. When the light gets up just right, you see one of the brightest and most delightful pictures imaginable. And the river is a mirror. And you have reflected it in the relieving and then the curving shore and the receding capes, all pictured in it. And when the sun gets up and falls, you have pink blush here, powder of gold over yonder, purple haze right where it'll yield the best effect. You grant that you have a picture that is well worth remembering. Now, how are you going to put all that on stage? It's impossible. Long here we have a fence, a long picket fence. It's at least 30 yards long. It goes down the corner and around. You can see the length of that fence now, can't you? Well, of course you can. And isn't imagination a wonderful thing? It's Saturday morning. It's spring, and the heat is getting to be so unbearable that, well, the hot, dusty roads are sending up shimmering heat waves, and all the boys in the village would have long since stripped their clothes off to go skinny dipping in the river, except for one thing. Their mother is keeping them at their Saturday chores. That's a mighty fine fence, huh? 30 yards long, all the way down the corner and around.
Tom! You, Tom!
That is Aunt Polly.
Tom, where did you go to? Oh, that boy will be the death of me.
Tom was sneaking around the woodshed a while ago, Aunt Polly. I saw him from my window. He had something under his arm. Maybe he's hiding in there.
Oh, the very idea. What are you doing in there?
Nothing!
What's all over your hands? In your mouth? What is this trash?
I don't know, Aunt.
Well, I know what it is. It's jam. I have told you 40 times to leave that jam alone or I'd skin you alive. Now, where's my switch? No water.
I'll cut a new one for you, Aunt Polly. Oh.
Tom, you get in there and get that whitewash bucket and brush. You are going to whitewash this fence, and no holidays until you're finished. I can't imagine the two of you being brothers.
Only half brothers, Aunt.
Well, all or half. I wish he was more quiet like you and not so full of old scratch, adventurous and troublesome ways. Why, every time I let him off, my conscience hurts me. And every time I hit him, oh, my heart most breaks. Now I'm obliged to make him work all afternoon, and he hates work more than anything. I've got to do my duty by that boy, or I'll be the ruination of that child. Now, Tom, I want 3 coats. Come along, Sid.
I'd sure rather have licking. She never licks anybody. Wax them on her head for them. Who cares for that? I'd like to know. She talks awful, but talk doesn't hurt. Anyways, you don't cry.
Hard at work, but I'd rather be swimming or fishing or anything. that the truth, son? I think you're a man who knows just how you feel. Say, tell me this. Suppose a rather dashing, handsome young doctor was looking to do a little fishing this afternoon. What would he like to catch the best?
Like down by Miller's Pond's the biggest.
Tom, I hear you talking. Oh, good afternoon, Dr. Robinson.
I'm always an honor to see the beautiful Miss Polly. And I was just telling my young friend Tom here what a fine job he's doing. But I better be going. Afternoon, ma'am.
Afternoon.
And you. Maybe I'll see you.
At the pond.
Now there's a fine young man. You could be just like him too if you put your mind to it. Now remember, three coats.
I'd sure rather have licking. That don't last long.
Buffalo gal, won't you go out tonight and dance by the light of the moon? I dance with the gal with the hole in her stocking, and he'll keep her rocking and tough keep her knocking. Whoa, Tom!
Whoa, Jim! Off to the pond?
Yeah.
My, it sure is hot out here in the sun. Ain't too bad where there's a shade of these trees. Say, Jim, I'll fetch water if you'll wipe my son.
Can't, Martha, Tom. I saw your Aunt Polly out front, and she told me you'd ask me to whitewash. And so she told me to run along and tend to my own business. She allowed you to tend to the whitewashing.
Never mind what she said, Jim. I'll give you marble. I'll give you a white alley.
Wow.
White alley, Jim, and it's a bully top.
My, that's a mighty fine marble. I tell you, boy.
And besides, if you do, I'll show you my store tunnel.
All right, give me the marble.
I thought I'd better check on you. Now, Tom, I'm going over to Sarah Ann Harper's. And I want you to remember three coats and no lagging.
Everybody will be coming by an adventure soon, and I'm stuck. I'll have to change my strategy.
Ting-a-ling-ling!
Joe Harper! If I can get him, I can get anybody.
Set out the skiff and take to your sounding! Ting-a-ling-ling!
Woo! Woo!
Set her to starboard, stern! Chow, chow, chow!
I eat your up stump, ain't ya?
Why, it's you, Joe. I wasn't noticing.
I'm going in and swimming, but you'd rather work, wouldn't ya?
Work? What do you call work?
Why, ain't that work? Maybe it is, maybe it ain't. All I know is that it suits Tom Sawyer.
You don't need to let on you like it.
Like it? Well, I don't see why I'm gonna like it. It's not every day that a boy gets to whitewash a fence.
Say, Tom, let me whitewash a little.
Well, I don't know. Aunt Paul's all tickling. Well, Jim wanted to do it, and Aunt Paul won't let him. And Sid wanted to do it, too. She won't let him.
Now, don't you see how I'm fixed? If you was to tackle this fence, and anything was to happen...
Ah, shucks. I'll be just as careful. And besides, I'll give you...
the rest of my apple!
Well... I suppose it'll be alright. But remember, ain't a point a thousand to do the way it's gotta be done.
Try at it?
Well, I don't know. It's powerful and important to have it done the way it's gotta be done. Besides, Joe gave me the rest of his apple for a privilege.
Say, Tom, I'll give you my pocket knife if you let me wait while some.
I got something better. I got a dead rat in this here bag and a string to swing it with.
Well, I suppose it'll be alright.
But you gotta switch off so everybody has a go at it. There's another brush in the shed.
I'll get it.
Well, so it went. Boys came to cheer and we made the whitewash. And when the strength of one played out, there were plenty of others to fill the ranks. And Tom had a right idle time of it all the while. Plenty of company. And the fence got 3 coats of whitewash on it. If Tom hadn't run out of whitewash, he'd have bankrupted every boy in the village.
Looks fun, man. Let's go swimming.
Yeah!
Tom had learned one of the great secrets to human action. Namely, that in order to get a man or a boy to accompany the thing, it's only necessary to make that thing difficult to attain.
Tom? Tom?
Land sakes, that boy. It's awful hot out here. I brought you a drink of water.
Laws on me. He's done. Well, he sure goes to show what a body can do if he puts his mind to it. He can do anything.
Now, Tom had been a great and wise philosopher like the author of this here story. He had come to realize that work consists of what a man is obliged to do. And play consists of whatever a body is not obliged to do. Mighty fine fence. Now that you folks have had some practice in imagination, we'll get on with our story. Sunday morning, the sun rose upon a tangled world and beamed upon a peaceful village like a benediction. Tom had set about getting his Bible verses learned, and Sid had learned his lesson days before.
Now, Tom, let's see what you know.
Blessed are the
poor.
Yes. Blessed are the poor.
In spirit.
In spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit. For they.
There's
4 hairs. Blessed are the poor in spirit. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Good, Tom. Now the next.
Blessed are they who mourn, for they
I don't know what it is.
Shout. Oh, shout.
You be quiet, Sid. Go on, Tom.
For they shall.
Shall what? Why don't you tell me, Mary? What do you want to be so mean for?
Oh, you must go and learn it again.
He'll never learn it.
Will, too.
He's been on the same verse for 3 weeks. He'll never win a Bible. 10 more verses and I'll have one.
I'll show you who win a Bible.
Come along, children. We mustn't be late. Have we learned all our Bible verses for today yet?
Some of us have.
Come along, Tom. Don't lag.
Blood's blue as yours is. Bluer even.
Hey!
first aid to horse manure.
You better go, Ma. You've been drinking.
Drinking? Of course I've been drinking. I dig graves for a living. 1 foot deep and drink 6 bottles of whiskey with everyone.
What a horrible person.
Ma, Father, come here. I want to talk to you. Come here.
Drink. Come on, children.
Did you hear what he called me? Well, he deserved it.
Why, Sarah Harper, how are you feeling?
Well, I am feeling just fine.
Psst, Jim! Have you got any yellow tickets?
Yes! What'll you take for them?
What'll you give?
Some licorice in a green glassy.
Let's see them!
You no doubt know the names of all 12 disciples. Tell me the first two you heard one.
Don't be afraid. Answer the lady her question.
You certainly built Tommy out, don't you? The names of the first two disciples were...
David and Goliath!
Let us draw a curtain of charity over the rest of this scene.
Next Monday morning, Tom played hooky from school. Had a right nice time with it, too, up on Cardiff Hill.
Playing Robin Hood with Joe Harker. Wearing only their long-tailed shirts and suspenders for sashes, and brandishing their lath swords, they went bounding through the trees, shirt tails flapping in the breeze, bare-legged, having a delightful time. So, wow.
Home! Who comes here without my pass?
God, kids, born wants no man's pass. Who art thou to hold such language?
I am Robin Hood, who that cake of carcass soon shall know. I will gladly dispute thee. How about thee?
These boys would rather be outlaws in Sherwood Forest a year than President of the United States for life. And when they got tuckered out, they went swimming in the river and got home in time for chores before supper. Tom was ready for Aunt Polly's questions, which were very, very deep.
Powerful warm at school today, wasn't it, Tom?
Yes'm.
Middling warm in school today?
Yes'm.
Bet you wanted to go swimming, didn't you?
No. Not very much.
Bet you're not too warm now, are ya?
Some of us poked our heads after school. Mine's damp, you see.
Ha ha ha. You be quiet, Sid.
You didn't have to undo your shirt collar where I sewed it just to pump your head, did you?
Let me take a look.
Oh, well, Father, I was sure you played hooky and went swimming, but I'll forgive you this time.
Well, now, if I didn't think you sewed his collar with white thread, this is black.
Sid!
Why, I did sew it with white thread.
Silly! I'll lick you for that!
Oh, hang that boy, can I ever learn anything?
Sid, you are mean and hateful. Tom's a good boy, Mama. He's just got a little mischief in him.
Laws, I know, Mary. Sid, would you get the pail off the porch, please?
Yes, Aunt Polly. Mama, why are you so hard on Tom?
I don't mean to be hard on him, Mary, but he's got more tricks in him than a traveling salesman. He never plays the one alike. How's about it to know what's a-coming? Oh, I'm laying up sin. And I'm suffering for the both of us, and that's the Lord's truth.
Aunt Polly!
Now what?
Stop talking dirt clods at me, Aunt Polly.
Oh, hang that boy if I don't lick him good this time.
Sid was not the model boy of this village, though he was not far from it. Tom knew the model boy and loathed him. All the boys loathed him. He was the apple of every mother's eye in the village. As far as having anything in his head, why, you could trade the contents of that for a pie, and nobody'd be any the worse off of it. Except maybe the pie.
Hello, Mr. Twain.
How you doing, Tom?
I'll take it in the air.
Yeah, care to go over a walk with me? Now, what's this new mischief I understand you're into?
I ain't going to school. I want to go to the hill, bathe and swim. I have myself all covered, and then sit squeal on me.
Oh, well, I heard a poet say once, the best laid plans of mice and men are often brought to naught.
Huh?
Never mind, Tom. Are you sorry you went?
No, sir. It was beautiful up there, Gloss. The river looked like dark green glass shimmering in the heat. I just felt Mr. Twain. Tell me about being a pilot on the river. That's what I want to do someday.
Well, right now, maybe later on you can do that.
Do you see that girl over there at Jeff Thatcher's?
I do believe that is Miss Becky Thatcher, Jeff's cousin from Constantinople, the town of Jeff's. I understand that she and her mother are going to be staying here for the whole summer.
I think she's the prettiest girl I ever saw.
She does have a mighty fine look about her, Tom.
So long.
Hello. Oh, hello. Let me see. It ain't very good.
Come on, let me see it. Oh, it's ever so nice. Now make a man. I wish I could draw.
I'll learn ya.
Will you?
When?
Right now.
See? It ain't very hard to draw. All you gotta do is know what you want it to look like before you start.
Let me try it now. You're the boy at Sunday school, aren't you?
Yes, Tom Sawyer.
You're Becky Thatcher. Do you really live in Constantinople?
Yes.
Does the courthouse really have a tin roof?
Oh, yes, it's very pretty. It sparkles in the sun, and in the evening it's golden and sometimes red.
Wow!
My father's a judge. He's going to be away at the state capitol.
He must be an important man.
He is. I didn't see you at school today.
Well, I have things to do.
What's that?
It ain't anything.
Please, let me see.
No.
Oh, please. I love you.
Oh, you bad thing. I never.
Then please come back, Becky. You're the prettiest girl I ever saw.
Hello, Huckleberry.
Hello yourself.
What you got in your sack?
Dead cat.
Really? Let me see. Where'd you get him?
Got him off the board.
Say, Huck, what's dead cats good for?
Good for? Cure warts with.
I know something that's better.
Bet you don't. What is it?
Spunk water.
Spunk water? I wouldn't give a darn for spunk water.
Did you ever try it?
No, but old Mother Hoffman, Bob Tanner did. He went and stuck his hand in an old stub where rainwater is.
In the daytime?
Certainly.
With his face in the stump?
Yes, at least I reckon so.
Did he say anything?
I don't know.
Aha! Talk about trying to cure warts such a plain fool way as that.
Why, you gotta go all by yourself to a spunk water stump,
and right as it's midnight, you jam your fist in and say, barley corn, ancient meal short. Spunk water, swallow these warts. And you'll walk away quick. 11 steps with your eyes closed, turn around 3 times, and walk on without talking to anybody.
Well, that is the way Bob Tanner done it.
You bet not, because he's still the warmest boy in town. I've taken off 1,000 worms that way. Sometimes I even take them off with a bean.
Yep, a bean's good. I've done that.
Say, Huck, how do you cure worms with a dead cat?
Why, you take your cat and go and get in the graveyard long about midnight when someone that was wicked's been buried. When it's midnight, a devil will come, or maybe 2 or 3. But you can't see them, you just hear something like the wind. And when they're taking that fellow away, you heave your cat at him and say, devils follow warts, cats follow devils, warts follow cats, and I'm done with you.
Did you ever try, Huck?
No, I ain't, but old Mother Hopkins told me.
Well, then I reckon it's so then. Because they say she's a witch. When you gonna try it?
Tonight, I reckon. They'll come after old Hoss Williams tonight.
But he was buried Saturday. Didn't the devils get him Saturday night?
Why, the charms don't work till midnight. Then it was Sunday. Devils don't slosh around much on Sunday, I reckon.
I didn't think of that. Can I come with you?
Of course. If you have fear.
A fear of tiny life. Will you meow?
Yes, and you meow back if you get the chance. Last time you had me meowing around till old man Hayes got to throwing rocks at me, saying, darn that cat!
Well, I couldn't meow that night. Amy was watching. Well, so long, Huggy.
So long, Mom.
Let me tell you about that boy, Huckleberry Finn. He was the juvenile outcast of this entire village. Son of the town, no good and cordially hated and dreaded by all the others of the village because he was idle and lawless and bad. but mostly because all of the children admired him so and longed to be in his lawless society and wished that they dared be more like him. Tom, like all the other children in the village, was strictly forbidden not to play with Huckleberry. So he played with him every time he got the chance. Wind made a faint moaning noise in the trees that night. But Tom and Huck made their way to the tombstone. The moon slipped in and out of the dark.
Say, Huggy, do you reckon the dead people like it first to be here?
I wish I know. It's awful solemn, like, isn't it?
Say, Huggy, do you reckon old Hoss Williams hears us talking?
Of course, at least the spirit does. There's his grave.
I wish I said Mr. Williams.
Let's hide over there.
What time do you think it is?
Must be close to the time.
Awful sunlight, ain't it? Those clouds covering the moon and all?
Right, spooky, all right.
Shh!
What's it, Tom?
Shh! There it is again!
Oh, Tom, they're coming. They're coming, sure. What do we do?
I don't know. Think they'll see us?
Oh, Tom, they can see in the dark. I wish I hadn't, Tom.
Maybe if we keep perfectly still, they won't see us. Look, what is it?
It's devil's fire. Oh, this is awful, Tom. It's devil, sure. Three of them. Tom, can you pray?
I'll try. Now I lay down to sleep. What is it, Huck?
They're human. At least one of them is. One of them's all for water.
Watch out, Boots. Here we come.
I ain't with you, fool. You still make enough noise to wake the dead.
Say, Huck. I don't know where the other voices. It's a Jim Joe.
That's so. I'd rather they were devils. What can they do?
Here it is, my dead man's treasure. Get to work. Get down. You. What's the matter?
Can't get the cork off my bottle.
Put it away. It'll be the death of us. Now dig.
All right, I'll dig. My buries and my digging up, it's all the same to me. As long as I get my pay.
He must be drunk, huh?
Shh. You think I hear something?
Oh, it's the wind.
Now hold it, man. When the moon comes out, someone may see us.
Wait, Sawbones. You'll add another five, or we no work.
That's a talk. I see another five, or I start with
them. Look here, Bimbo. You barred your morning in bands. Now pay you.
Yeah? You've done more than that. 5 years back, me hungry, I come for food, but you kicked me out your pa's kitchen. When me swear I get even, your pa get me thrown in jail. You think me forget? I got you now, you got set.
No, yourself!
Here I are, my pa.
Get that drunk! Morons! Joe, put it down!
You not be so bossy.
Joe?
I stick you.
Joe!
There now. That score's settled.
Did you see that?
Shh. William. Hey.
What'd you get me for, Joe?
Huh?
Wanna fall asleep? What's this, Joe?
It's a dirty business. What you do it for, my father?
I never done it.
Look here, that kind of talk won't wash.
Mine's all in the mother, I can't think. I never should have drunk tonight. Honest now, Joe. Did I do it?
You two were scuffing. He bet you could not. You come up, jam your knife into him, fall down drunk, there you lay.
I
I didn't know what I was doing, Joe. Honest. I ain't never used a weapon before, Joe. I fought, but I ain't never used a weapon, Joe. Please don't tell.
You've always been fair and square with me, my father. I don't go back on you.
You're a true friend. You're a true friend, Joe.
That's enough of that. You take these things. I finish with this. You be off yonder way. Go to Old Tannery. I come for you when it's clear. Leave no trap behind you.
Your name's Joe, your true friend.
The devil take you both.
Tom.
Now, Mary, it's not exactly tattling. Not exactly. I did ask about Tom.
Why do you need to run away? Good morning, Paul. Mary.
Run along to school, the both of you, so you're not late. Tom, I need to speak to you.
Don't be too hard on him, Mama. He's a good boy. He'll settle down when he gets older.
Goodbye, Aunt Polly.
Goodbye.
Tom.
Now, Tom, I'm not going to ask you where you went last night, because it would break my heart so. Oh, why do you go on breaking my heart like this?
I'm sorry, Aunt Polly. I won't do it anymore.
If you want to go ahead and ruin yourself, child, and go right ahead. I can't take it anymore.
Please forgive me, Aunt Polly.
Oh, heaven knows I tried. I just wore out.
Please don't cry, Aunt Polly. I can't stand it when you cry. It's more terrible than a thousand whippings.
Well, I haven't done right by bringing you up. My poor dead sister's boy, and I failed her.
I'm sorry, Aunt Polly.
Run along to school now. I've had my say.
Yes, Aunt Polly, I am sorry.
Thank you.
Sawyer. Joseph Harper, come up here. You two played hooky again yesterday. That's three times in 2 weeks. I just don't understand you two. And Thomas, you made a fool out of me in Sunday school. David and Goliath, I'm just gonna have to give you the whippings of your miserable lives. Tom, you're gonna be first. Now bend over. Hold on, what the devil? Children, just stay seated. I'll see what the commotion is.
Oh, did you hear the news? It's just the most awful thing.
Oh my, that is horrible. Will you hold on for a second? Children, a tragedy has occurred. Today, we're going to dismiss school.
Yeah!
I want all of you, though, to go straight home. Cemetery's no place for children. Don't go to the cemetery. Go straight home. Wait for me. Now, who found the body?
I don't know. I can't remember.
Go!
Tom, I come to find you. There's a whole lot of people up at the cemetery. Some people's even climbing trees, it seems. They say they found him last night by a body. They say someone saw Muff down by the Brook Washman's up this morning. Everybody thinks Muff's done it. They're going out to hunt for him right now. What are we going to do, Tom?
We gotta keep Mom there, Muff. We got him. If we say anything, you won't kill us. Come on, let's go watch.
Terrible crime had been committed, and all the evidence pointed to one man. And when that was decided on, the whole town was ransacked for the murderer. For you see, the public is not slow in the matter of sifting evidence and arriving at a verdict. Once Muff was found and presented with the evidence, his own knife, That would have convinced anybody that they were on the wire, but he just about fainted. In fact, he would have sworn that they hadn't caught him. That convinced them all the more that they had concluded rightly in the matter, and Injun Joe's story put the finish on it. Now, there were those who felt that with such convincing evidence, a trial was useless, and that they ought to be able to come up with swift and rapid resolve to the problem at hand. But their conscience took better action on the matter, and they put Muff in jail, and he was placed there for a good period of time. There were some who felt that Injun Joe should be tar and feather for body snatching, but so overpowering was his character that no one could be found to take the initiative in the matter, and so that was dropped as well. Well, by and by, Tom and Nut both had a wavering impulse to tell the story and to, break their secret oath and let them know that Muff was free of guilt. But the image of Injun Joe overwhelmed them so powerfully that they didn't get around to telling that story either. Why, Injun Joe made himself so mean in Tom's imagination, they felt for sure that he had sold his soul to Satan and that no earthly power could touch him.
Tom, you talk around pictures so much you keep me awake half the time.
Well, I have a tooth that pains me.
A tooth? Well, I'd better have a look.
It's all better now, Ann.
And you do talk such stuff. Last night you said, it's blood, it's blood. You said that over and over.
What you got on your mind, Tom?
Nothing I know of.
And you said, don't torment me, so I'll tell. Tell what? What is it you'll tell?
Oh, it's that dreadful murder. I've been dreaming about it almost every night myself.
So do I. I don't know if I can skip all this talk for another month until the trial.
Well, let's not think about it anymore. You children run off to school and go straight to school.
You're
Tom, don't you lag.
To be mum and wait. Finally, the dread hour of midnight arrived.
My coat was on that rack. What am I gonna do if it rains?
Oh, bother you.
as a body come to the top.
Yep, but I just wish I knew who it was.
I do too. I'd give heaps to know who it was.
Boys, I know who's coming down. It's us!
Yeah, it must be us. They must have found the raft, with my coat on it.
For us too. I bet they miss us, especially them that's done us unkindness.
Nobody misses us.
Of course they do, Huck. Because when bodies are gone, right, Joe Stick? Everybody feels sorry. I'm going over there tonight. I'm coming too?
No, you ain't.
Besides, I'm the captain and won't have too many of us come. I'll swim over to the near shore and catch the ferry boat on, sneak in Aunt Polly's. No, back for breakfast.
Yeah, Tom made his way over to the village unobserved and found Aunt Polly's home shrouded in gloom. Tom made a mental note of the conditions there, seen so that his report would be spiced with meaning. As he observed the sorrowful conversation from his hiding place, Tom was overwhelmed with a powerful feeling of homesickness. These were feelings that he had been pushing aside, fighting ever since the adventure began. But before he could give it a second thought, another mischievous plan took place in his head, and all feelings of homesickness fled in the wonderful urge of a brand new excitement.
He's done left us.
No, Tom's true blue. He'll come back. He won't desert.
Then where is he, I'd like to know? If he's not here by noon, I'm leaving and you can't stop me. I'm back so you can settle yourselves. Damn! It was us they was looking for on the river.
I snuck into Aunt Polly's house. Aunt Polly and Mary were crying.
Your ma was there, Joe. And even Sid was misty. They say nice things about you, Huck. How'd my ma look?
Terrible?
Sid, sorry she whipped when she throwed out the river sail.
Oh, boys, it's so lonesome here. Yeah, let's give it up and go home.
But Joe, you'll feel better by and by. Is there any better fishing place than here?
I don't care for fishing when there's no need to say I can't do it. I'm going home.
But Joe, there ain't any better fishing swimming place but here.
I don't care for swimming when there's no need to say I can't do it. I'm going home.
Fine then, let the crybaby go.
I reckon you want to see your mom.
Yeah, and you would too if you had one. We'll stay, won't we, Huck? You like it, don't you?
I don't know, Tom. I'm kind of tired of this here life, too. I don't have a mom, but I'd like to go back. Let's us go, too, Tom.
No, I mean to stay.
I wish you'd come, Tom. Now you think it over. We'll wait for you when we get to shore.
You'll wait one long time, then. Hey, wait! I was going to wait to tell you till later, but since you're deserting me, I better tell you now. When I was over at Aunt Polly's house, they was saying if they couldn't find our bodies by Saturday, they was going to have our funerals on Sunday. So I was thinking...
You don't mean to say,
I'm thinking, do you? We sneak in the church on Saturday night and appear when they're having our funerals.
Splendid! I can see their faces now.
Sounds fine, Tom. They're pirates.
Why, it's just the thing a pirate do. Come on, let's go swimming.
I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. These words of comfort and consolation at this time, this tragedy of these poor young lads, no longer will we feel of their sweet natures. No longer will we hear their laughter in our streets. No longer will we see them playing. Lord, preserve us!
Huh?
Oh, I'm glad to see him. Poor motherless thing.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. I know you know it, and I want you to sing it with all your heart. Ready?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here.
Mercy on us, go on.
And then Joe's mother said that he was
tell me about her rubbish about all this superstition. Come on, Tom, tell me some more.
And then Steve said, he said, I don't think I said anything.
What did he say, Tom?
He said, I think he said that he wished I was better off where I was gone off to. If I had been a little bit more well behaved sometimes.
There, did you hear that? It was your very word.
Aunt Polly shut you up sharp.
I did.
And then there was a lot of talk about dragging the river and having our funerals on Sunday. And then you, Mrs. Harper, left. She left. And you prayed for me. And I heard every word you said. That I took and wrote on a piece of signal card. Well, you did. Only I fired. And set it on the table by the candle. And then I thought I felt so sorry. Then I went and kissed you right on the lips.
Did you, Tom? What did you kiss me for?
Because I don't want to.
Oh, Tom, I can forgive you everything for that.
It was very kind, even though it was only a dream.
Hush up, Sid. You do the same in a dream as you do when you're wide awake. Now, you boys and girls have hindered me long enough. Now, get along to school, and don't be late. I can't wait to tell Sarah Harper.
Pretty thin, as long as the dream is that without any mistakes. Hello, Joe.
No, Tom.
Hello, Billy.
Hey, Tom.
Hello, Tom.
Hey, Champ.
Hey, Tom.
Hello, Joe.
No, let's
go play marbles.
Yeah.
Hello, Becky.
Hello, Tom. I'm so glad you're not drowned.
Did you really care if I was lost?
Oh, Tom, yes. I'm sorry if I treated you mean. Do you forgive me?
Of course, Becky.
My mom let you have a picnic at the cakes. Will you come?
Are we still engaged?
Why, of course, Tom.
Only a moment, Becky.
Tom, I gotta talk to you about Mom.
Shh!
There's darkness coming tomorrow, and I hear none of you.
Heck, you haven't gone and said anything about...
Why, of course not, Tom Sawyer. We wouldn't live 2 days if that got found out. You know that.
Well, I reckon we're safe as long as we keep Mom.
I reckon.
What's the talk around?
Oh, bad. It's got me in sweats as only to hide somewhere. They say he's the worst villain in this country, and they wanted he wasn't ever hunt a wolf.
I reckon he's a goner.
I reckon he ain't no account, but then he ain't ever done anything to hurt anybody. Just fishes a little and looks around considerable. But we all do that. And he's kind of good. He gave me half a fish once when there weren't enough for two. And then he's kind of stood by me when I was out of luck.
Well, he's making kites for me. I wish we could get him out of there.
We couldn't get him out, Tom. Besides, it wouldn't do no good. They'd catch him again. Why, if he was got free, they'd lynch him.
They'd do it to him.
I'm taking him some tobacco tonight. Want to come?
I'll meet you after school.
Go over to Sarah Lee Harper's and try to get me to make her believe all that rubbish about the dream?
And lo and behold, Joe's told her everything. You were here.
I wish now I thought, but I didn't think.
Well, child, you never think. Here you come all the way over from Jackson Island, hoping to make us believe all that rubbish. And you made me go to Sarah Lee Harper's and tell her that and make a fool of myself.
I know that was mean, but I didn't mean to be mean. Besides, I didn't come all the way over from Jackson Island to laugh at you that night.
Well, what did you come for?
It was to tell you not to worry because we hadn't gone drowned.
And what was all that rubbish you were telling me about the bark?
The bark that I wrote on to tell you we hadn't got drowned, only not pirates. I wish now you woke up and kissed me. I do, honest.
What did you kiss me for, Tom?
Because I loved you. And you were laying there moaning, and I felt so sorry.
Kiss me again and then go to bed. Boy, it was a good lie, though. Well, I pierced the look. I don't want it to be a lie. I hope the Lord will forgive him. Oh, Tom. Oh, Tom, I could forgive you a million sins for this.
Yeah, she blessed Tom many times. Her prayers slept through the night like a child wrapped in a mom's dream. Tom, on the other hand, spent a fearful night. Her conscience is a terrible companion. When he closed his eyes, he saw Aunt Polly weeping over him. And when he tried to push that vision out of his head, there was Muff Potter to take their place. Or worse, Injun Joe. Long in the night, a terrific storm came up, and oh my goodness, there was thunder, there was mighty crashing bells and cymbals of lightning. Why, he had not the shadow of doubt that all this hubbub was about him. He figured he had taxed the forbearance of the powers above to the extremity of endurance, and that this storm was to destroy him. It may have seemed to him a bit incongruous. It may have seemed to him even a little bit a waste of pomp and ammunition to kill a boy with all of this. But there was nothing incongruous about getting up such a powerful storm as this to knock the props right out from under an insect like himself. And by and by, the storm played out and died away. Tom decided that maybe he had been spared. But you know, there was always this terrible, terrible nightmare of his. His conscience continued to plague him. Now, for two more nights, as the trial of Muff Potter dragged on, his sleep was a horrible torment. Until he made a fatal decision. A trial is a curious thing. Nothing can stir up a sleepy atmosphere more than a good trial, especially if the verdict's a foregone conclusion. All that remains is the argument to satisfy the minds of the citizens that they had judged rightly in the matter and that their lust for the culprit's blood was respectable.
Your Honor, by those of the citizens whose simple words above suspicion, as might I add, has not been refuted by questions or cross-examination by the defense attorney, we have shown the actions of the miserable prisoner at the bar on the night of his murder. He was seen I was the next morning near the crime, washing himself in a brook. His weapon, which was found near the victim's body. When I presented to him, not like this, he had swooned. We also have a sworn affidavit, signed and testified by Mr. Joseph, Mr. Engine Joe here. He stated in this affidavit that an argument ensued over money. My father, in his anger, took this knife and he did stab.
Objection, Your Honor.
Sit down, Counselor. He stabbed Doc Robinson till he was dead. We have shown our case. And now, Your Honor, we rest our case.
Your Honor, at the beginning of this trial, the defense had in mind to admit that this humble prisoner did the fearful deed while under the evil influence of alcohol. However, we have changed our mind and shall not offer such plea. Your Honor, please call the bench. Thomas Sawyer.
Your Honor.
Sit down. Have a seat, son. Thomas Sawyer, tell us, where were you the 17th of April? About the hour of midnight.
In the graveyard.
A little loud, son, please. Don't be afraid.
In the graveyard?
In the graveyard. Mm-hmm. Tell us, were you anyone near Hoss Williams' grave?
Yes, sir.
Just a trifle loud, son. How near were you?
As near as I am to you.
I see. Were you hidden or not?
I was hidden.
Well?
Behind the elms that are on the edge of the grave.
Mm-hmm. Anyone with you?
Yes, sir. I went with.
Wait, never mind mentioning your companion's name. We shall call him later. Did you carry anything there with you? Remember, my boy, truth is always respectable. What did you take there?
Only a dead cat.
Let the boy speak. Your Honor, there is relevance. And we shall produce remains of the dead cat later. Now, my boy, tell us, what in heaven's name were you doing in the cemetery with the dead cat?
We went to give a walk with it.
Mm-hmm, I see. Probably not a remedy that dashing, handsome young doctor would have recommended. Your Honor, it's not so important for us to establish William Thomas is in the graveyard, only that he was there. Now, my boy, pay no heed, no attention to this heinous prosecutor. Tell us everything that I could. Tell him your words, don't skip nothing, and son, don't be afraid.
We went to cure Thomas for the dead cat when Doc Robinson, Muck, and the engine Joe came, and there was a fight, and Muck was knocked down, and engine Joe?
Tom Sawyer, me kill you for this!
No! Tom! No!
Well, as the usual, Tickle the World took Muck Potter to his heart and received him as freely as it had abused him before. But that sort of conduct is to the world's credit, and you ought not to find fault with it. Tom's days were days of jubilation and exaltation, but his nights were torment. Why, he was absolutely certain that old Injun Joe was going to wreak his horrible revenge on both Tom and Huffy. So, for a good long while, he just decided he was going to take care of the matter, but nobody could find Injun Joe anywhere. After a period of time, he was pretty much forgotten, figured that they'd lost him to some other territory, and days were much happier for months thereafter, and there were many things that were much more delightful to Tom.
Now you children stay together. Come back here! Now, everyone get a partner. Get your candles from Mr. Biggs at the cave entrance. Everyone keep together and don't wander off. Don't push over there. You children, come along.
Oh, Becky, this picnic is such fun. And going to McDougal's cave is so exciting. Come on, Susie. Oh, I'm coming. Ask her what you can stay at my house.
All right, I'll ask her. If she says yes, I'll get you on the line at the front door.
Okay.
Say, Becky, instead of you going to the Harper's tonight, we'll climb right up the hill with the Widow Douglas's. She has ice cream. She has almost every day. Loads of it.
Oh, that would be fun, too. But what will Mama say?
Oh, shucks. Your mom won't know. So what's the harm? Besides, all she cares about is that you get home safe.
I guess you're right.
Come on, Becky. Let's go get our candles. I know this cave as well as any man in the county.
McDougal's cave. Vast, labyrinth, crooked aisles, chasms that led nowhere, ran into each other and ran out again. It was said that one might wander for days through the twisted rifts and chasms, never find the end of the cave. No man knew the cave, or some young man knew a portion of the cave, but it was not only practical for them to go much beyond that portion. Tom Sawyer knew as much of the cave as anyone.
Oh, I'm tired playing with In and Out.
I know a place where we can ride our bags.
You can rest there. Look at all the names they've written here already. Come on!
Everyone start back to the entrance. It's getting late.
Stop to listen. All you can hear is your heartbeat.
Well, I didn't notice, but it's been ever so long since I heard any of the others. We better start back.
Yes, I reckon I could get us back. All we gotta do is go back the way we came.
But can you remember all the turns? I hope we won't get lost. It would be so awful.
Listen!
What is it?
Bad! We can't go back that way. Say they put our candles out. Then we'd be lost.
Oh, Tom, I'm afraid.
We'll get out, Becky.
Let's go back. I don't care about the bats.
All right. I think it's this way.
They'll miss us and hunt for us. Maybe they're hunting now.
I sure hope they are.
When will they miss us, Tom?
Well, your mother doesn't miss us the ferryboat landing. She misses when she got home.
But Tom, Mom isn't expecting me. I told her I was staying at Susie Harper's. I wish I hadn't done it, Tom. We're gonna die. This is what I get for lying.
Stop, Becky. We'll get out.
Tom, we're lost!
Nothing more terrifying than the pitch blackness of the cave. You cannot see your hand touching your nose. Your eyes, blind, cannot comprehend the depth of the darkness. Then there's that eerie echo of voices. Minute drops of water. Heartbeats thundering across the damp, musty clay walls. This deep stillness had grabbed the heart of Tom Beckett.
Why, Sarah and Harper, where's my Becky? Is she going to sleep all day? I knew she'd be all tired out, but she should be up for church with your children.
You, Becky, didn't you sleep over at your house last night?
I know. Susie, did you say that Becky couldn't come in?
Well, I ran at the ferry boat landing, and she said that she had to meet me there, but she couldn't stay the night.
Oh, dear. Good morning, ladies.
Oh, good morning.
Sarah, yeah, I have got a boy that's missing. And I suppose he stayed at your house after the picnic?
And now he's afeared to come to church. I've just got to settle with him.
Well, he didn't stay with us.
Joe Harper, when was the last time you saw my Tom?
I don't recollect exactly. I don't remember seeing him on the ferry boat.
Neither did I, now that you mention it.
I reckon it was at the cave.
Oh, mercy on us.
What's the matter, ladies?
Well, Tom and Becky are missing, and they might still be in the cave.
Well, that sure sounds like young Tom, all right. It's a little out of character for Miss Becky. Don't you worry, ma'am. We'll find your daughter. You boys, graze up the town and make sure it's searched real good. I'm going to head on up to the cave and start looking. Now, if you don't find her here, you head on up there.
Yeah, let's go.
Well, the alarm spread from group to group. Before long, the whole town was up and searching. And when the children could not be found, why, within 20 seconds, bells were chiming, the town was out searching. When they couldn't locate the children, they were off down the high road and down the river searching for Tom and Becky, and led by none other than Muff Potter and Huck Finn, valiantly in the lead. Inside the cave, there was no spirit of excitement. The two children were wearied out from wandering through the labyrinth of the passages.
I can't go on, Tom. Here, sit over here. Maybe you should go to sleep and get some rest.
Oh, how can I get to sleep again? I wish I had never waked up before.
Well, we'll get out, Becky.
But what are we doing when our candles go out?
Well, I just have to go to the store and feel our way along. It's lucky I brought some extra.
But Tom, those pitfalls. If we don't have candles, we can't see them.
We'll just have to go to the store and feel our way along, and we won't fall into any of them.
Oh, Tom, I'm so hungry.
You remember this?
It's our wedding cake, Tom.
Yes, I wish it was as big as a barrel, but it's all we got. I bring it from a picnic for a journal of the way grown-up people do with wedding cake.
But now it'll be our...
Please don't cry, Becky. Shh! Did you hear that?
What? I didn't hear anything.
You sounded like a far-off shout. They're coming for us, Becky.
Hello! Hello! We're over here! Call again, Tom. Hello! Hello! I can't hear them anymore. Hello!
Hello, Tom Sawyer.
You come to me, Tom Sawyer. I'm going to kill you. There's a pit over there, 100 feet deep, water at the bottom. I'm going to throw you down there, Tom Sawyer, and your little girlfriend. You'll drown like rats.
Please, Mr. Joe, I had to tell.
Now you have to die.
Tom!
Put him down, Joe!
My father?
That's right, Joe, and I ain't drunk this time now. Put him down. You youngins head off out that way. What's the matter, Joe? You yeller?
Yeah.
I see. You think you're the only one gonna leave this cave alive, huh?
I stick you like I stick Doc.
Oh.
Thought I told you youngins to get out of here. You could have killed us all.
How long have you run, Buck?
I'm not the real hero. Tom here is the real hero. You saved my life, Tom. And I'm glad I got to do the same for you. Suppose you're going to get the reward for finding old Lindsay Joe.
Me? But you!
Nah, I just came along when you found it. Now, let's get out of here. I'm tired and there's a whole posse of people.
Well, that was mine and rejoicing when Tom and Becky were found. Moth and Huck were made heroes for finding them.
Tom and Becky were heroes for being found. And that would have been the end of the story. Except for one thing.
When Tom made his way out of the cave, he left the trail back to where he'd met Injun Joe. So later on, when he and Huck went back to kind of explore around the cave a bit, they come across Injun Joe's belongings, and there was a stash of cash right there. When counted up in the light of day, amounted to $12,000. Since nobody could be found who was claiming the ownership of the money, it was given to Tom and Huck, put out at 6% interest for the year, and why, Tom and Huck were just to wonderfully enjoy all of the treasures of that game and all of the wonderful times that they had to share from that time on. And Huck was given over to the care of that wonderful lady that has always enjoyed taking good care of boys and girls. And she was given over to the care of Martha, or Huck. And he was put in the place in her complete charge from that day forward. Well, Huck is going to be coming from the Widow Douglas any minute now. So we'll just see if we can find old Huck and his new suit. Where's the suit the Widow Douglas got, Chuck?
Oh, this gold suit be fine, and I ain't ever gonna shake it anymore. Them other clothes smother me, they're so rotten nice. I can't sit down, I can't lay down, I can't roll around anywhere. I gotta wear shoes on Sunday, I gotta go to church on Sunday. The widow eats by a bell, she goes to bed by a bell, she gets up by a bell. Everything's so awful regular, her body can't stand it.
Well, that's what everybody does, huh?
Well, I ain't everybody, and I can't stand it. Hey, Huggy, where have you been? Widow Douglas is looking for you.
Well, she ain't gonna find me, because I'm quitting. Being rich ain't all it's cracked up to be. Just worry and worry and sweat and wishing you was dead all the time. You can go and beg off of me at the widow if you like.
Well, I can't do that, Huggy. That ain't fair. Besides, if you'll try this thing a little longer, you'll come to like it. Won't he, Mr. Twain?
Oh, yes, he certainly will, Tom.
Like it the way I'd like a hot stove if I was to sit on it long enough? No, Tom, I won't be rich and I won't live in them smaller houses.
Looky here, Huck. Being rich ain't gonna stop me from adventuring. In fact, I've been planning on turning robbers.
Are you in real Deadwood Ernest, Tom?
Why, Deadwood Ernest is not standing here. We can't let you in the gang, Huck, if you ain't respectable, you know.
Can't let me in? Didn't you let me go for a pirate?
Yes, but that's different. A robber's more high-toned than a pirate is. Like, in most countries, they're high up in the nobility ranks, dukes and such.
You wouldn't shut me out, would you, Tom?
I wouldn't want to, but what would all these people say? What they say? Tom Sawyer's gang. Pretty low characters, ain't it? They mean you, Huck. You wouldn't want that, would you?
Well, I'll go back to the widow and see if I can stand it, if you'll let me be in the gang.
All right. No, I swear to let up on you.
Will you? That's good. Say, Tom, when are you going to start the band and turn robbers?
We'll have the initiation tonight. Maybe.
The what?
The initiation. To swear ourselves together, and even if we're chopped to flinders, not to tell our secrets. No, that's got to be done in the awfulest, lonesomest place you can find at midnight.
That's something I like.
And all that, you got to swear it in blood. On a coffin.
Why, that's a million times bolder than pirating. I'll stick to the widow till I rot. And if I get to be a regular ripper of a robber, and everybody talking about it, I bet she'll be glad she snaked me out, will it? Good night, Mr. Twain.
Good night, boys. Good night, my boys. Yeah, I hope you like it.
I probably ought to do a sequel to this story. I think I might call it The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Thanks for coming. You all come back and see us again sometime, yeah?